southeast corner of Alaska lies one of America's great natural treasures, the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. Established in 1960, the refuge is the only place in the United States, and perhaps the world, that protects an entire spectrum of Arctic and subarctic ecosystems. Even by Alaska standards, the Arctic refuge is incredibly diverse. The subarctic forest thins and gives way to the majestic peaks and glaciers of the Brooks Range, which bisect the refuge and give birth to its great rivers. To the north, the rugged mountains drop away to foothills, then to a treeless tundra, which gently rolls to meet the coastline and the ice floes of the Beaufort Sea. This refuge remains the essence of wilderness, a place where one may still stand atop a nameless mountaintop, gaze 20 miles down a magnificent valley, and feel the heady sensation of being utterly alone. But of the entire 19 million acre refuge, unquestionably the most biologically important and the most fragile part is the coastal plain. This region of braided rivers, foothills, and undulating tundra has been biologically self-sufficient. Now that self-sufficiency is threatened by oil and gas development. Wedged between the mountains to the south and the Beaufort Sea to the north, the coastal plain is the center of wildlife activity on the refuge. This critical zone is, at varying times of the year, home to a unique gathering of Arctic wildlife. In late winter and early spring, grizzly bears leave their dens and move to the tundra in search of food. Polar bear sows and cubs emerge from maternity dens. Wolverines find plenty of prey to feed their young. Over 100 bird species nest here on the tundra. Some birds, such as pectoral sandpipers and ruddy turnstones, tundra swans and Arctic terns, travel from as far away as the Chesapeake Bay, California, and even Antarctica. Before the turn of the century, muskox in number were reintroduced to the refuge in the 1960s and have since flourished. Today, it is the saga of one animal in particular that most dramatically symbolizes the wild of this place, the caribou. Each summer for thousands of years, this animal has returned to the plain to give birth to a new generation. This cycle of life begins hundreds of miles to the south and across the border in the Ogilvie Mountains of Canada's Yukon Territory. For 7 months, this has been the principal winter home for the porcupine caribou. In good years, the river will have lost most of its ice before the cows begin to arrive. But in other years, the cows must face the awesome force of an Arctic river during breakup. In spite of the danger, the cows plunge into the river. Some gain a brief rest by clambering onto floating ice, but for others, the massive force of the ice will be too strong. Many may be crushed or die of exhaustion. The Porcupine is not the only thundering river the cows must ford. Already weakened from the long winter, the caribou will cross several more rivers, brave predators, and suffer meager nourishment in their urgent exodus to the plain. it is difficult to understand the instinct that drives them forward. Biologists believe it is the unique qualities of the coastal plain that lead them to undergo such an arduous journey at such a vulnerable time. In spring, the area offers relative freedom from predators, as well as new plant growth that will provide maximum nutrition for the cows and calves. Scientists have also observed that on the rare occasion when the cows cannot reach their refuge before calving, the herd will complete the journey after calving. This profound migratory drive may serve to establish the instinct among new calves. By the first week of June, the cows reach the border of Alaska and enter the refuge. Spring in the Arctic happens suddenly. One day, the land appears permanently locked in the grip of winter. Then, winter seems to vanish, bringing on a rush of new life. The increasing hours of sunlight stimulate a spectacular show of wildflowers on the tundra. Here, the abundance of forbs, sedges, and lichens is what the cows have struggled so hard to reach. And here on then they give birth to their calves, 90% of them within a critical 2-week period. Precocious animals, caribou calves can walk within an hour of birth and keep up with their mothers within 3. They have to be quick because they face a threatening world. The balance between life and death, health or failure of the caribou population is a delicate one and intricately timed. By the 3rd week, all of the porcupine herd is gathered on the refuge. The result, one of the greatest wildlife spectacles left anywhere in the world. Not since the bison roamed the Great Plain has North America witnessed anything like it. And like the bison, the caribou provide a primary source of food for native people in Canada and Alaska. One group, the Gwich'in Indians, refer to themselves as the caribou people. So closely linked is their survival and that of the herd. Any threat to survival of the caribou becomes a threat to the survival of the Gwich'in. For good reason, the Arctic refuge has been called America's Selene. Scientists call this immense summertime gathering of the caribou herd the post-calving aggregation. Most who have witnessed it call it unforgettable. During the brief Arctic summer, calves and adults alike must constantly feed in order to put on layers of fat to sustain them through the fall migration and the long winter ahead. Any activities that threaten this crucial caloric intake or require extra expenditure of energy could, over the long term, spell doom for these animals. Repeated episodes of being startled to flight by predators or other intruders, or having their movements blocked by industrial activity, could tip the scales of survival. In July, the caribou face a new threat, insects. Millions of mosquitoes and flies thrive in the tundra wetlands and are more than just a nuisance. Given the right conditions, mosquitoes can harass a small calf to death. Parasitic botflies and warble flies can seriously weaken an adult. To combat this insidious enemy, the caribou range widely across the coastal plain, moving to the windy ice floes of the Beaufort Sea and to the foothills of the Brooks Range for insect relief. There, cooler temperatures and breezes offer some respite. By August, the porcupine herd begins to drift out of the refuge. By September, the fall migration has begun. Fattened and strong from the summer's feeding on the refuge, the herd begins the long journey south to its Canadian wintering grounds. The annual ritual, thousands of years old, has ended once more. Behind them, the tundra of the coastal plain sports its rugged fall colors. Ptarmigans begin to change their camouflage to winter white. Grizzlies are busy harvesting berries. Soon they will move to dens in the higher reaches of the Brooks Range. Soon, too, pregnant polar bears will leave the pack ice where they have spent the summer hunting in the rich coastal waters. In midwinter, some of them will give birth within their dens on the coastal plain. Muskoxen will spend the harsh winter here, well sheltered by undercoats of kibia, which is softer and warmer than cashmere. In fall, a second wildlife spectacle occurs on the coastal plain. Hundreds of thousands of migrating waterfowl use the narrow strip of land as a stopover point. Tundra swans, Arctic terns, golden plovers, king eiders, and loons. Perhaps most spectacular are the snow geese and black brant. Upwards of 300,000 geese use the coastal plain as a staging area, feeding, resting, and gathering strength for the rigors of the long flight south. Such are the rhythms of the coastal plain, a rare place of wild beauty, a place so remote and fierce that it remains practically untouched by man. But there are plans underway that could change the face of the Arctic refuge forever and drastically affect the fate of the porcupine caribou, along with numerous other species. In 1987, the Department of Interior released a report about the coastal plain, its wilderness and wildlife values, and its oil and gas potential. The report found that the 1.5 million acre strip is the center of wildlife activity and the most biologically productive part of the entire refuge. According to the final report, oil and gas exploration and development would displace and reduce wildlife populations. Natural processes would be diminished, and there would be a major reduction in the value of the areas as a pristine natural science laboratory. The wilderness qualities and values of the coastal plain would be eliminated. Despite these findings and the agency's admission that there is only a 1 in 5 chance of finding a mere 200-day supply of oil, the Reagan administration recommended that Congress open the entire area to leasing and development. Despite several efforts to pass legislation authorizing drilling, Congress has rejected pressure from the oil lobby and its allies. No bill allowing drilling has passed. Just what would development mean? A vast network of roads and feeder pipelines would be constructed along with living quarters for thousands of workers. Air and marine traffic would be at times almost constant. For each exploratory well, millions of gallons of fresh water would be needed, a scarce commodity in the Arctic desert. Millions of tons of gravel would be dredged from river bottoms to build airstrips, roads, and drill pads. Habitat loss would be tremendous. Development would act as a barrier to the free movement of wildlife, especially the porcupine caribou. And the unmatched Arctic wilderness would be lost forever. Just west of the coastal plain is Prudhoe Bay, a giant oil field. Oil can be a dangerous neighbor to the natural world, as we learned with the Exxon Valdez oil spill in Prince William Sound. At Prudhoe Bay, air pollution is already a problem. The vast industrial complex has half as many nitrogen oxides as New York City. Toxic waste has spilled onto the tundra or leaked out of inadequate storage pits. Monitoring of environmental damage at Prudhoe Bay has been little and late. Long-term consequences are still unknown. Of 1,100 miles of Arctic Ocean coastline long, because of its peerless wildlife and wilderness values, and because it is so remote. Ironically, that very remoteness may now be its undoing. For those who advocate development, the coastal plain is bleak and barren. Because it is so distant, development advocates say, the wilderness and wildlife values have little relevance for most Americans. Just such an argument was made over 100 years ago by those who opposed the establishment of the cornerstone of our national park system, Yellowstone. The Arctic Refuge may well be the Yellowstone of the 21st century. Protected, it will certainly be a lasting and more valuable legacy to future generations, with its musk oxen, polar bear, and caribou herds intact. Protected, the herds would continue to support the people who depend on the caribou for nutrition and other cultural values. Development would mean an outrageously expensive hunt, just a few months' worth of oil, if there's oil there at all. Studies show that alternative sources, greater energy efficiency, and conservation can do far more to prevent an oil crisis than exploitation of this rare, wild place. We can guard this precious place and honor the great tradition of American conservation, or we can squander our children's birthright on uncertain short-term economic gain. In many ways and on many levels, the quality of all our lives, not just the Gwich'in Indians or the thunderous caribou herds, will be affected by what we decide to do with the fragile magnificence that lies at the top of the world.
1,000 generations, but now oil companies are pressuring Congress to sell out our last great wilderness. This is the birthplace and summer feeding ground of a great caribou herd. It is the center of Gwich'in culture and life. Join me, Peter Coyote, to help stop the oil companies and the destruction of the Arctic Refuge. Call 202-224-3121 and urge your senators to protect the Arctic Refuge. Ah!
This is your host, Mitchell J. Raven, and we're very glad that you're joining us again today. Today we're going to have another very interesting show. As you saw from that opening footage, is that something? This is the subject of today's show. We have Sarah James with us here, who is the Chief Executive Officer of the Gwich’in Steering Committee from Alaska. She lives in Alaska, in Arctic Village, in a very pristine area with her people. They've been there, actually, they say, from time immemorial. And they're doing what they can to, as you got some sense from the video, protect the caribou and protect the ecosystem in general there, and a way of life that has been there for a long, long time. So we're very glad to have Sarah here. She is in New York to let people know, to take the story out into the world so people know about the tragedies that are afoot in Alaska with the oil companies that are doing everything they can, to some extent in conjunction with the federal government, to exploit the land, drill, and basically carelessly disregard the very precious, very sacred land that's up there. So Sarah, thanks so much for being on the show with us today.
Thank you. I'm honored to be here on your show.
Well, welcome. And we're very glad that you're here to bring us this mission from, and these words from, the very heartland of Alaska.
Mm-hmm. I feel like I'm part of this life because that's how I grew up. I grew up off the land. My parents raised me off the land, out in nowhere, where we are there to survive and live on very little, based on needs, not on greed. So when I was put into a Western school, when I was 13 years old, it was alarming to me how much waste and greed is out there. And I still can't get over that. It's still a problem for me. And that's one of the reasons I'm traveling to save a special place in the world still working ecosystem, and a lot of.
So you were living the life of your tribe.
Yes.
Until age 13.
Yes.
When you were put into an American public school.
Yeah.
And so your original language was the Gwich'in.
Yes, Gwich'in.
Pardon
Gwich'in.
My.
Gwich'in really means indigenous people. If you have a problem, say Gwich'in and put G in the front, it's Gwich'in.
I see.
Yeah. So.
Then you started to learn of Western ways and saw the greed, saw the waste, saw the carelessness.
I still have a problem with it. And
So many of us.
Yes.
And those of us who are raised within it.
Exactly. And we need to come together and change our way of thinking and go out of your living room and into your living room and talk about it to your relatives and friends. And that's how we've been fighting this issue since 1988, and we've been winning, and it's because of the grassroots people.
And if you could just outline for our audience just what is the issue specifically, what is it?
Mm-hmm. It's a porcupine caribou calving ground. It's a birthplace. It's a sacred place.
Mm.
It's a 1002 area or Arctic coastal plain of Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. It's up in the northeast Alaska. And the caribou go over there for thousands of years because it's a safe place and it's a healthy place to have their calf.
Yes.
So they've done that for thousands of years.
It's their birthing place.
Yeah, it's a birthing place. Any birthing place or a spawning or nesting is a sacred to us because that's how animals always stay healthy where they're born.
Sure.
And that's very important.
And your people are sustained by the caribou.
Yes.
I mean, it's not like a glancing relationship. I mean, you live with their hides,
uh-huh.
You live on the meat.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
it's
you
tools.
Live in a place, huh?
Yeah, tools and food.
Tools, yeah.
75% of our diet is wild meat, and most of it is caribou. Caribou, moose, sheep, fish, and ducks, and some birds, and that's how we live up there. We live by fishing, and we take care of the land, and in return, they take care of us, and that's how we live, and that's who we are as a caribou people. Because if it wasn't for caribou, we probably won't survive the cult you know, Western culture that came to us with the disease and everything else that we had to live through. And caribou tend to migrate through our country and revive us every time, and that's how we live even today, because before the Western culture ever came to us, we used to be a healthy nation of 100,000 Gwich'in people, and the only thing we used to die of was old age, because we were well organized and we were healthy and strong. But now today there's only less than 10,000 Gwich'in between all the 17 villages of Northeast Alaska and north of Yukon Territory, Canada, and Mackenzie Delta area of Northwest Territory. There's three border between us, but we're same people, same Gwich'in people. We speak Gwich'in as our first language, and we got relatives through that boundary, and the caribou go
you
through
mean,
the boundary.
From Alaska to Canada. And then, what's the third boundary?
Northwest Territory. Territory, Yukon Territory, Alaska, U.S. Territory.
Yes.
So the caribou don't see the border. They migrate through the whole the three border plus up to the north of Eskimo country, and they come back through our country, and they did that for thousands of years. So
your people have remained at least somewhat intact, even despite the encroachment of Western culture and corporate interests and the like.
I mean, right.
It sounds that way. Is that so?
Yes. Yeah. Because we still hunt and fish, and that's how we live, and that's how come our diet is 75% wild meat.
And what is the other 25%?
Western food, you know, from what we can get in from the stores.
But you can't. I mean, traditionally, you weren't able to grow food there.
No, we
can't. So you're never able to grow food. So it was always hunting and fishing.
Yes. And exactly. And they want to develop up there because they said there's oil there, potential for oil, but they only see about 6 months supply for the nation that they're going to drill out. But they don't even know if that's how much they're going to get.
And well, it might not even be that much.
Yeah, it might not even be that much.
An economic loss. Mm-hmm. It's highly speculative. So why bother speculating with land that is so dear and precious to everybody in general and to your people in particular?
Yeah, I call it a miniature jungle because it feeds so much and diversity in that area, and it's also it's so tense that if there's ever oil spill, it's just going to seep into the tundra and it'll go into Arctic Ocean. It's going to affect the Arctic sea animals, and it'll affect the caribou, and that would be the last of our whole ecosystem.
It's really, you've made tremendous progress already.
Yes.
Thank God. You know, you have really started 11 years ago, actually.
Right.
And by taking your story out to the world, you have gathered a tremendous amount of support.
Yes.
You know, and more is needed, needless to say.
Exactly.
But, I mean, you really have a track record.
Right.
And this is very good news. In our last few minutes, you had mentioned something about they're being endangered, the Yukon River as well, up in Alaska. Do you want to just take a few moments and share that with us as well?
The Arctic National Wildlife Refuge coastal plain is on the other side of Brooks Range, and we like to keep that pristine and clean and all that. But this side of Brooks Range is another water ran into Yukon River. Yukon River starts in Canada and all the way across Alaska onto Bering Strait. So that river, if you've been on the air over the Mississippi River, you can see Mississippi River in each. There's a strip of natural line right at the bank of the Mississippi River, but the rest is checkerboard. And Yukon River is still wild, And there's a lot of fish that, mainly salmon fish, spawning into watershed.
How is it being jeopardized?
And it's running into the Bering Strait, and a lot of our fish came from there.
Yeah.
But now, with a military maneuver through the Alaska during the Cold War, they left a lot of garbage behind. Alaska was once a gold rush. So there was a lot of mining happened, and they need to clean up. They need to clean up their garbage.
Yeah.
And that's what's happening with Yukon River Intertribal Watershed Council, and they got together. 38 village came together in the mid of winter when it's 35 below, and they met in Galena Village along the Yukon, and mm-hmm. took a position to clean up, and then there'll be more villages coming in, and even Arctic villages are a watershed of Yukon.
Right.
It's Chanelaw River runs off the Yukon, and then in the east fork of Chanelaw River, that's where Arctic Village is at. So we are the watershed of the Yukon also.
It comes down to something incredibly simple. Taking care of Mother Earth is our job. She takes care of us. We must take care of her.
Exactly.
It's a reciprocal mm-hmm. relationship. Mm-hmm. We've agreed to it.
Mm-hmm.
Anything that gets in the way of that must be challenged and rectified.
Mm-hmm.
That's all.
Yeah.
And we can do it very reasonably and very simply and very straightforwardly, as you and mm-hmm. the steering committee and
yes.
all the work, the great work that you have done, is doing. So we ask for your help. That's all. Read the literature, contact Sarah and the steering committee, get educated so you can use your own power wisely. Sarah, thanks so much for being on
Thank
the
show. Thank you, my and I said, thank you, all my relation. I'm honored to speak here.
Absolutely, great. So glad you. This is Mitchell J. Rabin for A Better World. Thanks so much for joining us. You'll see the phone numbers after the show, and look forward to seeing you all next week. As you and the steering committee and
yes.
all the work, the great work that you have done, is doing. So we ask for your help. That's all. Read the literature, contact Sarah and the steering committee, get educated so you can use your own power wisely. Sarah, thanks so much for being on
Thank
the show.
Thank you. I said, thank you, all my relation. I'm honored to speak here.
Absolutely. Great. Glad you did. This is Mitchell J. Rabin for A Better World. Thanks so much for joining us. You'll see the phone numbers after the show, and look forward to seeing you all next week.